one of the largest in the country right now. There's people from all over the world that come. I think when I last saw, there was a little over 16,000 educators and admin and whatnot that go to this conference. So it's a huge event. It's a privilege for us to get to go. I've spoken to you a lot, but in case you don't remember, I'm Casey. This is Tyler Gates. He's our technology coach, going around the building, helping quite a bit. And then Virginia Duncan is an instructional coach at high school this year. So we all got to go. Unfortunately, we had four or five teachers from the high school that were supposed to join us on Sunday, and they were not able to get out of Garden City. That's a downfall, a little bit of just having one or two flights out of town. So they actually missed the entire conference, because by the time they would have got there, they would have missed the most of it. So we would have been a much bigger group, and actually it's really great, I think, for our teachers to be there. So we did it last year. We had quite a few that we were able to take with us. So I think as we look forward, that's a great group. I know Yuri was supposed to go with the robotics and bring back a lot of information and so forth. So we'll continue to look at that. But we shared the presentation with you, so we're not going to read through all that with you. Just to let you know, ISD, besides the conference, you get a year-long membership to be a part of that community. Lots of information that comes from people all over the country that share just resources, best practices, lots of information about what other districts are doing in ed tech and bringing technology into their schools. That's one step, but not just the equipment, it's how is instruction changing and what are we doing to get our kids ready for some of the things you've heard tonight with CTE and those kinds of things. So as we kind of talk about it, that's the focus there is on the conference, but there's so much more that goes into just having that opportunity to interact with all those folks that are attending. So,
and the Avid, there's we just found out this just recently that Avid and ISD actually have this alignment. So Avid actually submitted their indicators, which is like their rubric that they have with all their indicators for approval, and ISD put their like seal of alignment on it for the digital indicators that they have, which is kind of a neat thing that they're actually connected.
So I think we'll just each share a little bit of our own takeaways, since we have three different roles. We all kind of went to the conference looking at things from a different perspective. So I'm going to let Tyler kind of go first. He's just going to share a little bit, and we'll just kind of go through.
Yeah, so as technology coach, I mean, ISD is the conference. There's not a huge pool of technology coaches in this part of the world to collaborate with and bounce ideas off of. So being able to sit down and have the opportunity to learn from some of the best technology coaches around is invaluable. It's one thing to follow somebody on Twitter. It's another thing to sit down in the same room as somebody and be able to have a dialogue back and forth. So that was great. You know, it's still a relatively new position, so kind of learning best practices and hearing their success and failure stories has helped tremendously. Like, for example, just one thing that I came away going, okay, yeah, I should have thought of that. As a technology coach, do you focus on kind of reaching as many teachers as possible in the district and just kind of doing surface level help? Or do you focus on a few teachers and really go deep with them and they can kind of then help? And so that's an example of something that kind of, that sparked that thought in my mind. So I'm doing a little bit of both right now, for the record. Understanding what a technology coach is and is not, so you kind of walk this fine line between this is what I'm supposed to do and this is a job for somebody else. So, for example, I'm not tech support. Teachers don't want me fixing their printers, looking out worse. So, and I really geek out about having this digital tote with resources. You go to these breakout sessions and you get this digital tote to take back. My personal look back at that information dozens of times, trying to kind of come up with my own stuff. And so you get that, and you're able to remember that session, and this person said that, and it's just great to plug those pieces in. So big picture kind of takeaway for me, hearing what other tech coaches have said, I've come back and implemented appointment slots where teachers can book appointments with me one-on-one throughout the district. And I'm also doing a building rotation where I'm in several buildings a month for teachers to come to me with questions and help, and they can go to their classrooms. And I just, ISTE was a great, it just made me think of so many things that I otherwise would not have thought of. So it was awesome.
Okay, so in addition to actually going and attending and getting a whole bunch of information that we were able to bring back, I was a presenter and I had four different sessions that I presented. And one of them was about professional learning challenges, which was about challenge-based professional learning for teachers, where they're not just gaining information, they're actually kind of investigating a little bit and then applying in their classroom. So, and they choose their different level and the different I linked in there, you can go into the presentation and link into it, it'll show you an example of what those challenges look like. So we are actually on challenge number two right now, and we're kind of making our way through that, so that's exciting. I also did another presentation on how it's really important to continue to grow ourselves in order to grow others as coaches. If we don't grow ourselves, it's impossible to grow other people. So it was focused on that. And in another one, I'm focusing on long-distance PLNs. And then I was an ISTE Ignite session presenter talking about professional learning, looking at it from different perspectives, not just confining it to one way of professional learning, but thinking outside the box for professional learning for teachers. And then Ethan is here because he was actually selected as a student presenter, which is like really rare for a student to get selected to be a presenter at a teacher conference. And so he's going to tell you what he talked about a little bit.
So I talked about my dance YouTube channel and about how it was created and going through how you don't just put something out there, you put something out there that's going to be meaningful to you and that's going to be an impact to the world, and also about how teens put themselves out there at a very young age and they grow up global, so we need to teach them about how to do that.
And so you talked a lot about like global communication skills and the importance of that, and not just being a digital citizen but being a digital leader as a teenager. So he has since then actually from that been published on a blog from that speech and everything from Media by Example and Jennifer Casata, who wrote Social Media. So he's kind of been recognized for that. My takeaways, not only is it an opportunity to learn and grow from others and professionally network, lots of resources and ideas, but the importance of connecting an instructional coach with a technology coach and focus on learning first and how we need to be closely partnering and working on professional development for teachers in that way. So that was huge.
Great. I'll just share a few things from our role. Suzette alluded to it, the on-demand training. I attended quite a few sessions on professional development because we're pretty knee-deep in with our one-to-one and reaching out with teachers and sitting with them and talking about not just here's your device and here's how to use it, but here's your device and here's what we can do with it when it comes to instruction and how it can adapt your learning to it, when's it appropriate to use it, when should we stick with the models you're used to using, those kinds of things. So as we talk about professional development and what that looks like for our staff, with the on-demand training that they've started offering through her department, we're actually starting to implement some of that. We presented this last 2 weeks, some things on technology that they can specifically go and do and get credit for themselves personally. They dig into Microsoft or Google or Apple. We kind of present all three because we offer all three in our district. It's opportunities just to help them grow in those areas that they choose to grow in. And we found quite a bit of interest. It was the first time we did it, so I think there was just some hesitation. What is it? What are we doing? What are you actually presenting on? So I think as word gets out that we're trying to offer those opportunities for them not just to come and sit and get here's some 101 kind of basic level things. We want to actually challenge them to start taking those next steps and look at some other ways to just grow, one, their own skills. What we told them is if they're nervous about using an app or using something in their classroom they've never done before, the best way to do it is to get in there and play and make it yourself. Make an iMovie, make a Clips, get in those apps and actually create from their point of view, use it as a student, and then dig into it. It makes it so much easier when they start to actually try to incorporate that with their classes. So we're continually looking at ways that we can increase our professional development, kind of help them, at least from the technical side. STEM and STEAM are big topics at this conference. It's everywhere when you're talking about robotics or makerspace or when you walk around the expo hall, there are hundreds of vendors who are trying to sell stuff, obviously, but they're also, it's just a neat way to see what's new out there, what can we possibly be doing, not just to increase STEAM and STEM, but all areas of instruction. But these are two pretty big topics. And our district's doing a lot of great things already. So when we go, we're also looking at, okay, what can we do to help those programs along? What are some new things that we could help them find? Whether it's equipment or whether it's just curriculum, and then what can we do to support them once we get back? What kind of resources should we be pouring into those areas? Two topics that we don't do a lot here in our district, but were high items when you walk around the vendor area, but you also look at the sessions that were offered. One is augmented reality and virtual reality. We are looking at that. We've been researching for a little bit. I know we presented a little bit last year on it during the budget time. But with those opportunities, there's so many great avenues for new ways of kids to learn material. And it's pretty amazing when we use some of those products in class, the limited ones that we have, just to see the kids' engagement pick up for the spark in their eye when they pick up their iPad and kind of go like this and look around the Golden Gate Bridge or you know, the Roman Colosseum, things that they may never see with their own eyes. Hopefully they get to, but we know that the reality is, I mean, I've not seen the Colosseum and probably won't. So being able to be right there engaged in that is pretty amazing for a kid, especially when it's embedded right in the story that you're reading in class and you can kind of take them there. Does it become the focus of the lesson? Not so much. You're still worrying about the story you're trying to teach them, but it enhances that opportunity for them to kind of see something firsthand that they may never get to see. And then coding is kind of the last big one that is really a big push right now. And when we think of coding, I think we think of apps that are out there and how do I become, how do I learn to write an app? How do I get into this? But really, it's becoming that second language that kids are needing to know, needing to learn, because it's that critical thinking. It's being able to say, I wrote this little piece of code and I made this robot do that, or I did this on the screen and this little thing did that. Just that process of adapting and learning how to write that code and then seeing results from it is huge. And I think we see it when we talk about robotics, not just the driving aspect, but if you've been, there's that coding aspect. And kids are really engaged when they get to see the products of what they're doing. So we don't have a full coding program in our district at this time, but we've kind of begun some discussions with the instruction department on what could that look like, what should we be, what kind of resources should we be digging into, what's the right level to start at, where should we go with that. There's a pockets here and there. Robotics is one pocket, but we've got some science teachers who've done some things that are really great. When you go in their classroom, see kids doing different apps that are code-based instruction. So there's already some interest out there, and I think we just need to build on that as we look at, you know, what's a good step for our district as we look into that. Because it is a growing area that I think our kids really would benefit. Even if they're not going to go into a technical field or, you know, something that directly involves coding, just that process of having to create that and write that is huge. So that's you know, a lot of the big things for us. We'd be happy to answer any questions, but at the same time, we want to say thanks for letting us be able to go and kind of engage. Like Tyler said, just being to be around other professionals who are looking at the exact same things we're trying to look at as our district is, from little small districts to districts way bigger than ours, just to see the interest and are we hitting things in the right targets and are we kind of focused on the right things. And so it's great to get that feedback. So any questions for us? Laura?
Just in case somebody who's watching doesn't know, what's STEM and STEAM?
Science, technology, education, or math and
engineering.
Sorry.
And
then STEAM has arts.
Okay.
As well.
Because we talk STEM a lot, but I don't know if we've used the acronym STEAM a lot, so
yeah.
I just wanted to make sure if there was someone watching who didn't know what those were,
right,
that they would know.
Yeah, STEAM adds the art section. Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, thanks.
Question for the students. So why were you selected or how were you selected? Was there a process application?
So you have to do an application, and then they have to accept.
What grade were you in?
I'm a sophomore.
Thank you.
Other questions?
I did have one. You mentioned earlier, Casey, something about a virtual budget reality app.
Virtual reality? Uh-huh.
Did we have one of those for our budget?
Oh, for the budget?
Yeah.
No.
Just want to be.
I don't know how virtual a great spreadsheet would look. I mean, visual world, but I thought we could work with KT on something.
I'll work
fantastic.
On that.
Yeah,
okay. That'll be at the next meeting. We'll have that.
Oh, thanks, Casey.
You'll get top billing.
That's right.
Well, I appreciate you taking the extra effort and being a presenter as well. That's pretty awesome to do that at such a high level.
Yep.
Well, I'm sure that took a lot of planning and work to get that together as well. So I'm glad that seemed to be something that really, it feels like it inspired you all, like, you know, you kind of get that energy when you go to conferences.
Sorry it didn't work out for the rest of the team to make it.
Yeah, they were pretty hard working, I think.
Yeah.
So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
play the combined game against Liberal because Liberal didn't have enough players to do two teams this week. And since we're here at KH, if anyone is interested, 7 o'clock tomorrow is the band concert. So if anyone wants to attend that, and then Jazz Band is having a concert at the high school tomorrow. I think it's 6, so you could hit both concerts, I'm sure. So just a few things happening in this area. Thanks.
I just wanted to thank everyone for hosting the State Board of Education and Dr. Watson on the Western Kansas tour. I wanted to just kind of review what we had done out here, but 8 of the 10 board members were able to participate in that, and the plan was to come out to, they call it Western Kansas, but it was really Southwestern Kansas because we went to Liberal, Garden City, and then Dighton. In Liberal, we had a community meeting at the first part of it, and basically during the community meeting, Dr. Watson went over and discussed redesign and what he hopes redesign to accomplish, and tried to explain that to the community and the people that were attending that, and that was held at the Liberal Chamber of Commerce. The next day, we also went to Meadowlark Elementary, which is a redesigned school, a very new school down in Liberal, and also to Liberal High School, which is also a redesigned school, just kind of both places to see how they're implementing different things to help students learn and to take more control over their own learning. In the afternoon, we came up to Garden City High School, and we had a very nice tour of the high school for all the members, and they were very impressed. So that went really well. We also had a meeting with the area superintendents that came and visited, which was really helpful because for them to go to Liberal and see their giant high school and to Garden and see a big high school, it's not what most Southwest Kansas schools are like. So it's helpful to have those other area superintendents there. And then we had a community meeting in the evening there for people to listen to the redesign plan and what we hope to achieve through that. And then the next day we went to Dighton and visited their elementary school and then their middle school, high school to see their redesign plan. It's really helpful because some of the state board members represent districts that are largely urban and they really don't have an understanding of the diversity and the ruralness and sort of the remoteness as well. So it's all just like when all of your friends come and visit you in Garden City and then they talk to you about how far they had to drive to get here, it's really helpful for other people to understand that because we all drive that direction and don't think much of it. We just know it's going to take a little while. So I think it's really helpful for that. And it's really also helpful for the community to understand what redesign is meant to accomplish. So it's an individualized way for each school to meet the needs of the community and of their students. So thank you all for, you gave a great representation of Garden City and really appreciate it. So I just wanted to say thank you and hopefully they'll come out again sometime.
Well, I'm really thankful that we got to go and out of the
I think they've already went home, but Mr. Stoppel, want to publicly thank Mr. Stoppel and the students, and they were excited about the board being here for the meeting tonight and getting to do their building report and showcase some of what they have going on. I know the tour guide we had, she had a lot to say in a short amount of time and did a really nice job, and so appreciate all their involvement. Gene, please extend a thank you also to the state board for taking time to come out and for being here. Seems like we've had a lot of visitors this fall, and I don't think that's by chance. I think people recognize there's exciting things happening in Garden City, and it is wonderful to be able to showcase the great students, the great people we have in our schools, our faculty, our staff, and all the great things we have going on here. So we appreciate that. Crystal Apple is really right in the middle of things. Six finalists, all USD 457 employees. Laura, help me with the date of the banquet. Is it the 14th?
Yes.
So if you don't have it on your calendar, November 14th, that's the evening for the banquet. Let me know if you can make that work in your schedule, please. And I think there's a pretty good chance we're going to have Dr. Watson back out for that. No?
No, I messed up because usually it's the Thursday before Thanksgiving.
Uh-huh.
So I told him to reserve November 21, but National Education Week is the week before, and he had a couple of other things going on, so he probably will not be able to make it this year.
All right, well, he told me last week he still had it, but maybe he didn't realize the date issue. So I'll confirm.
I talked to his secretary.
Okay.
I trust her.
Yeah, she probably has this scheduled down better. And then also, this is National School Principal Month, so that's starting around on social media. We'll be doing some more stuff with it, and just kind of recognize and thank our principals for all of their work. And I didn't know we had a National School Principal Month, but I learned that a few days ago. So we'll be making sure they know we appreciate what they do during the time they're recognized. So thanks.
Meeting will take place on Monday, October 21st, 2019 at 6 p.m. in the board meeting room at the Educational Support Center.
Okay.
Oh, to adjourn.